بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As you know, inshallah ta'ala, this will be the last haraka before the month of Ramadan. And so we will dedicate this haraka to answer the questions that we received about Ramadan, inshallah ta'ala. So this is Ramadan Q&A session, as you know. So before we answer those questions, I'll just give some general fiqh rules about fasting. And these rules actually will cover most of the questions. And for those who are, inshallah ta'ala, with us online, our viewers, if you have any question during the halaqah, you can just, inshallah ta'ala, send it in the comment section, put it, and then Brother Daifullah is here, will be following with me if we receive any questions online. But we will answer the questions that we had from before first, and then after that we'll open the floor, inshallah ta'ala, to everyone. The brothers who are in the masjid are with us physically, and those who are listening to us right now. As you know, subhanallah, we might have Taraweeh this Friday, not sure yet, but most likely the beginning of Ramadan will be on Saturday, but inshallah ta'ala will confirm with you this coming Friday, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. A few days left to receive Allah's divine and noble guest. We pray and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who witnessed the blessed month of Ramadan, and inshallah to make the most out of this month, to make it a source of forgiveness and a source of inshallah joy and happiness for each and every one of us. Allahumma ameen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the Qudsi hadith, Allah the Almighty says, kullu amal ibn Adam lahu illa as-siyam fa'innahu li wa ana ajzi bih. Every action of the son of Adam is for him. This is a Qudsi hadith. Every action of the son of Adam is for him, except the fasting, as Allah says, that is for me, and I will reward him for it. Every action of the son of Adam is for him, except the fasting that is for me, that is solely for me, and I shall reward him for it. And we will shed, inshallah, some light on this hadith in the next khutbah, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. What does this mean, that every action is of the son of Adam is for him? We know that every single act that we do is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah ta'ala, we'll talk about this briefly in the next Friday. But this is, as again, it's a special act of worship, right? Very beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is a source of forgiveness. One of the greatest sources of forgiveness is actually the act of fasting. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Man sama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaban, ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi." Whosoever fasts the month of Ramadan with iman, with complete faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ihtisaba, hoping for its reward from Allah, then shall have his previous sins forgiven. All of his previous sins will be forgiven, with two conditions. Condition number one is to fast for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the sole intention is to earn the pleasure of Allah. And then the second condition is ihtisaba. And ihtisaba, the ulama says, is to fast with a desire for it. Yani meaning, while fasting, you should feel that you are performing a special act, like an act of worship that is so beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the believer for whom fasting will have its desired effect of removing his previous sins approaches the month of Ramadan with love for it. You know, you participate in the month of Ramadan with a sense of excitement. It's not just, I can't wait for this month to be over, or I'm tired. This is part of ihtisaba. Not simply fast, but some people sometimes while fasting, Sometimes they can't wait for Ramadan to be done. It looks like it's a heavy burden on them. So part of the meaning of ihtisaba is to have that love, a desire to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while performing this beloved act of worship. So this is, as you know, fasting became mandatory upon Muslims in which year? Does anyone know? The second year of the Hijrah. So the obligation of Ramadan or fasting was made mandatory upon Muslims in the second year of the Hijrah. So actually for 15 years, from the time that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the revelation for the very first time, for 15 years Muslims did not fast a full month. They didn't fast the month of Ramadan. The month of Ramadan was there as a month, as a name. Because these 12 Islamic months, actually they were there even before Islam. So the people know about the name of Ramadan, but its fasting was not made mandatory upon Muslims until the second year of the Hijrah. Before that, for 15 years, they used to fast for a few days. Right? As Allah says, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً. Days that are very limited in number. Like the day of Ashura, as Aisha radiallahu anha says, we used to fast the day of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram. Like once a year, a day or maybe another day. But Ramadan officially became obligatory upon Muslims in the second year of the Hijrah. And you know that the second year of the Hijrah, many religious obligations actually were made mandatory upon Muslims. Like fasting was one of them. And also zakah is one of them. Hajj was made even mandatory later on in the sixth year of the Hijrah. So salah is probably one of the earliest acts of worship that was made obligatory upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not even too early. Not that early, because it was during the Prophet's ascension or during Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, which is Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj took place 3 years before the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right, that's after the death of Abu Talib, the Prophet's uncle, and the death of Khadija radiallahu anha. عَلَى مَنْ يَجِبُ الصِّيَامِ. So the first question which will cover or will answer most of the questions that we received, most of them are simple. Some questions I think are very important that we need to answer them. عَلَى مَنْ يَجِبُ الصِّيَامِ. So upon whom fasting is mandatory? Upon whom? Four conditions. Upon every, عَلَى كُلِّ. Upon whom fasting was made mandatory? Every, Muslim. Baligh, adult, Aqil. Yes. Aqil, which is sane. Yes, sane. And one more. Healthy. Capable of fasting. Qadir ala siyam. So yajib siyam ala kulli muslimin. بالغ عاقل قادر على الصيام. These are the four conditions, right? So fasting is mandatory upon every adult or every Muslim adult sane, capable of fasting. Even though, as you know, adult meaning that when someone reaches the age of puberty, however, parents are highly encouraged to train their children to fast at a young age so they can get used to it. And this is what the Sahaba told us, that they used to make toys actually stuffed with cotton. And then whenever the children cry during the month of Ramadan out of hunger, we would give it to them to play with, just to make them forget the feelings of hunger and thirst. So parents and guardians are actually encouraged to train their children to fast at a young age. And in the very beginning, sometimes they fast half a day, right? Most of the day, and just slowly, inshallah ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith you know, رفع القلم عن ثلاثة, right? رفع القلم عن ثلاثة. The pen has been lifted from three people. The pen is raised or has been lifted from three people. Means that they're not responsible for their actions. These three types of people are not responsible for their actions. So رفع القلم عن ثلاثة عن النائم حتى يستيقظ. From the sleeping person until he awakes, right? So whatever happens during your sleep, then you will not be held responsible for your actions while sleeping, right? Yeah, for example, someone slept and missed a prayer, right? Then he will be forgiven, and then he needs to make, he does not make it a habit, of course, but if it happens once in a while, or he fell asleep and it happens sometimes even with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time they prayed the Fajr after the sun rises, which is took place. So inshallah ta'ala, what happens, just someone was overcome by sleep, then the pin has been lifted from that person. And then the second person, وَعَنِ النَّائِمِ حَتَّى يَسْتَيْقِظُ وَعَنِ الْمُبْتَلَى حَتَّى يَبْرَأُ. And also the pen has been lifted from the insane until he comes to his senses, until they become sane. الْمُبْتَلَى حَتَّى يَبْرَأُ. Or another narration says الْمَجْنُون حَتَّى يَعْقِلْ. The insane until he becomes sane. So that person, if subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not will for him to be cured during his lifetime, then he will be straight to Jannah. Whether that person is from Muslim parents, non-Muslim parents, he will be straight to Jannah and will not be responsible for their actions whatsoever. Or you can say mentally unstable. The mentally unstable person and does not actually distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. And then the third person, وَعَنِ الصَّبِيِّ حَتَّى يَعْقِلْ. And then from the child, the Prophet said, until he grows up, he didn't say حَتَّى يَبْلُغْ. Actually, the hadith didn't say حَتَّى يَبْلُغْ. The hadith didn't say until they reach the age of puberty. The Prophet says, until he grows up, which is subhanAllah. Actually, in fact, many acts of worship in Islam does not go by the age of bulugh. Many acts of worship of Islam does not go by the age of bulugh. Sometimes bulugh or the age of puberty has nothing to do with it. Like for example, zakah. Zakah does not go by the age of bulugh. Like even if you have a month old baby, and you put money, you save the money for him, and you put account under his name, and then that is, zakah is mandatory upon that money, and his wali, his guardian or parents must pay it on his behalf. So it has nothing to do with the age. Even salah has nothing to do with the age. The Prophet ﷺ said, teach your children to pray at the age of 7. Right? Teach 7. No one reaches the age of puberty at the age of 7. And also there is no hadith that says fasting is upon those who reach the age of puberty. If someone is capable of fasting before that age, then they should start fasting. That's a very, very important. So the hadith says, وَعَنُ الصَّبِيَّ حَتَّى يَعْقِلْ. Until the, وَعَنُ الصَّبِيَّ حَتَّى يَعْقِلْ. And يَعْقِلْ meaning that he's able to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. Right? So subhanAllah, sometimes يعني a person becomes even responsible before that in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyway, as we cover now, that يجب الصيام على كل مسلم, then every Muslim adult, sane, capable or healthy, قادر على الصيام. So these are the four conditions. But there are some people, not fasting is permissible for four types of people. Some people are exempted by the Sharia from fasting, and then they need to pay the kafara, right? Or to make up those days after the month of Ramadan. Very important before we move on. Some people sometimes they take the easy way, and the easy way is to pay the kafara. So just if they missed a week or so, especially for this is very important, especially for sisters, right? The menstruating sisters during that time when they get their period, sometimes they break their fast for a week, 4 or 5 days, and after the month of Ramadan, instead of making up those days, they take the easy way, thinking that it's okay, it's optional to fast or to feed. Actually, feeding is not permissible for them. You only feed if you're not capable of fasting. You only feed. This is that's a plan or option B. Option A is to fast. Option A is to fast. Who's not supposed to make up the fast? If someone cannot fast altogether, even inside Ramadan or outside the month of Ramadan, such as, for example, elderly men and women. Right. This is one type of people that, by the Sharia, if they fast but with difficulty and they struggle to fast, then they are exempted. And of course, by old age, they're not going to get younger after Ramadan. So old age, then fasting is not actually permitted for them completely. So after the month of Ramadan, not after the month of Ramadan, during the month of Ramadan, they need to pay the kafara. They need to pay a kafara to feed one poor person for each day. This is for someone who's not capable of fasting. Like, for example, due to old age or maybe sickness, right? Sickness also, there are two types of sicknesses. One sickness that, what they call it, someone who's chronically ill. Like, for example, diabetes or cancer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us. And those people, they have to take medicine the rest of their life. Some of them, they have to take insulin after every single meal. So they cannot fast. And they cannot make up that fast altogether, right? Because they need to take their medication. So in this case, subhanAllah, they need to feed or to pay the kafara. But if someone got sick a couple days during the month of Ramadan, due to severe headache or stomach ache or something like that, and they had to break their fast, you cannot simply go after Ramadan and just pay some money, right, equal to the days you did not fast. This is not permissible, and this is not enough, it's not sufficient. You have to make up the missed days. So option number one, if you're able to fast, you have to fast. I'm putting a lot of emphasis on this point because I came to know that many sisters actually are feeding instead of fasting. I came to know that many sisters are feeding instead of fasting. So I just take the easy way, I pay because I don't want to fast. This is not permissible. This is not permissible. Just make sure that it does not work this way. So this is that's option number one is to fast. Option number two is to feed only in one case if you're not capable of fasting. So now you have elderly men and women and the sick people, and then someone, for example, have difficult jobs. And this is their only source of income. Only source of income. Difficult jobs. And they work, for example, all day under the heat of the sun, and they might get dehydrated, and they might risk their life if they fast, and this is their only source of income. Then the Sharia actually gives them the permission to break their fast and make up those days after the month of Ramadan, not to feed, because they don't work. Sometimes they do work 7 days a week. If they have 2 days off or the weekends off, they must fast after the month of Ramadan during the days that they are off. So those who have difficult job under what they call it, severe conditions. You know, there are some people, for example, criminals who are sentenced to life imprisonment with hard labor. لما بيسموهم في بلادنا محكوم عليهم بالأشغال الشاقة المؤبدة يعني their entire life will be in prison, plus with that they give them very hard labor and they cannot fast. And subhanAllah, so for their case, inshaAllah ta'ala, they can not to fast during the month of Ramadan. And in this case, I'm sure that even they're not even capable of feeding, So they need to reach out to their local community or local mosque to pay that kafara on their behalf. Right? And then you have also al-hamil wal-murdih. إِذَا خَافَتَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمَا أَوْ عَلَىٰ وَلَدَيْهِمَا. The pregnant and the breastfeeding, the nurse and mothers, also are exempted by the Sharia to break their fast during the month of Ramadan and make up those days after Ramadan if they are capable of fasting. Because sometimes after pregnancy you have to breastfeed, and then the next Ramadan might come while still breastfeeding, then there is no way to fast. Then in this case, inshallah ta'ala, they just can take option two or plan B to feed one poor person for each day. And this is subhanallah, if their doctor, a trustworthy doctor, says this is not safe for you to fast or not safe for your baby, unborn baby, not safe, then you must listen. Because if you fasted, for example, and I face this, Allah, I know my doctor said I shouldn't fast, but I want to fast. If you actually fast and God forbid something happened to you or to your unborn child, then instead of getting the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you end up actually committing a sin. Because Allah says in the Quran, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها and ولا لا ضرر ولا ضرار. There is no harm nor causing harm. So if the doctor says do not fast because this is not right for you, then you must listen, inshallah ta'ala. If there is a chance to make up those days after Ramadan, then do it. If not, then you can just pay the kafara. And for those who pay the kafara, they should not wait until the month of Ramadan is over. They just need to pay. They can do it day by day, or you can just pay the entire kafara in the first day of Ramadan and inshallah get it done, right? Because this is something that we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is another norm. And then of course the al-ha'id wal-nufasa, those who are menstruating or they have the post-childbirth bleeding. Al-ha'id wal-nufasa, also during the month of Ramadan, they cannot fast anyway during these days. So they will break their fast and then make up those days, inshallah ta'ala, after the month of Ramadan. Very important also, if you missed any days, you want to make sure that you have to make up those days before the next Ramadan. Because if the next Ramadan comes and you didn't make them up without any valid excuse, just nothing but laziness, out of laziness, right? Then you will end up actually paying a double kafara. Double kafara for those who do not fast until Ramadan. This is coming. For example, some people have some days to make up from last Ramadan. For example, and until today they didn't make up, they didn't make them up. And Ramadan already is in 2-3 days. Then without any valid excuse other than laziness, then in this case they will end up actually paying double kafara. Fasting plus feeding. But if there was a valid excuse, right? Valid excuse, then inshallah ta'ala, in this case, you just stick to one of the two options, whether fasting or feeding. Fasting if you're capable of fasting, or feeding if you're not capable of fasting. Lots of people also, they ask about fasting while traveling. As-siyam fil-safar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, there are many ahadith, right? يعني one of the hadith, for example, النبي قال ليس من البر الصيام في السفر. He said it is not from righteousness to observe fast on a journey. ليس من البر. But this has a particular case. It's a kind of long story, right? But you have the permission while fasting, while traveling, to fast or not to fast. And the Sahaba, they said, كنا نسافر مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فمنا من يصوم ومنا ما يفطر ولم يعب الصائم على المفطر ولم يعب المفطر على الصائم. At the time of the Prophet, we used to travel with him. Some of us used to fast. Some of the Sahaba used to fast while traveling. And some of the Sahaba decided not to fast. And none of them criticized the other one. None of them. Neither did the person who was observing fasting criticize those who did not observe, or the opposite. So it happened. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam allowed both of them. You want to fast? You're capable, go ahead. And if you're not, then you just break your fast and make up those days after the month of Ramadan. Because sometimes you come across very complicated situations. Very complicated. Like some people sometimes they say, Sheikh, my flight is going to be around 4 and then at Maghrib time, I'm going to be there. Sometimes it's very complicated. So the best way, subhanAllah, to take the rukhsa, to take the rukhsa, the concession that Allah has given us, right? Especially in complicated cases, when you're flying or something like that, and then at Maghrib time, you do not know what time and where you at, and very confusing. Then just take the easy way. يعني just stick to the easy way and take the rukhsa. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says in the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَى رُخَصُهُ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَن تُؤْتَى مَعْصِيَتُهُ. وفي رواية, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَى رُخَصُهُ كَمَا تُؤْتَى عَزَائِمُهُ. Allah likes that his concession, his rukhas, be taken. Just that he likes his commands and his decisions be followed. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a sadaqah, or a gift, just take it. Accept Allah's gift, and inshallah, especially and apply it in the most complicated scenarios or in the most complicated cases. By the way, very important. This is might sound weird, but that's the case. يعني المسافة التي تبيح للمسافر القصر في الصلاة هي نفس المسافة التي تبيح للمسافر الفطر في رمضان. What type of fasting that allows you to break your fast? What type of traveling? The same travel that allows you to shorten your prayer is the very same travel that allows you to not to fast. There is no one type of fast for shortening the prayer and one type of fast for shortening the breaking the fast. The same, whatever, the travel that allows you to shorten your salah is the same travel that allows you to do what? To break your fast during the month of Ramadan. Might say, yeah, Sheikh, but these days we have cars, we have ACs, we have very comfortable back then, they used to travel for days. This technology does not change that Allah's deen. Just let me be very careful. Technology does not remove that concession that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. So if you travel, for example, or every day, 1.5 hour, 1 hour, 15 minutes, or even less, and you know driving and sitting, and there is no zero hardships, still, driving by the car or driving by a camel or a horse does not really change the concession or does not lift the rukhsah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us. But Allah says in the Quran, وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. In all cases, fasting is better. If you only knew, this is what the Quran says. Fasting is better. If I do not want to, yes, you have the rukhsah, you have the concession. You have the signal, the green light. Not to do it if you want to take the easy way and this type of safar that allows you to shorten your prayer, the same type of safar that allows you, inshallah ta'ala, to not to fast during the month of Ramadan and to make up those days after Ramadan. I know very few people who take that option, but just from the amana of knowledge, we have to say this, inshallah ta'ala. Very important question, inshallah, before we... Let's take a look here. Some people ask about vomiting, اللي هو القيء. هل يفسد الصوم أم لا? Vomiting. What do you think? Huh? Yeah. Intentional. Vomiting breaks the fast. القيء عمدا. Right? That's it breaks the fast. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in the hadith, من غلبه من غلبه القيء فلا قضاء عليه. If one was overcome, he couldn't, for some reason, couldn't control it, was overcome by vomiting, then he just continues his day and then does not need to make up that day after Ramadan. But if someone vomited intentionally, he put his finger inside his mouth or did something to do it, then that day is not valid anymore, and they need to make up that day after Ramadan. Another important question came, can I pay the kafara overseas? Can I pay my kafara if I don't fast the month of Ramadan? And you know there is $10 per day, which is $300 for the entire month. And lots of people, they say, can I send my kafara to my country? There are more needy people over there and a lot of hunger and starvation. And so can I send my money to Egypt, to Yemen, to Afghanistan, to Pakistan, Bangladesh, instead of paying it here? Is that permissible? It is permissible. It is permissible, inshallah ta'ala. If this is also the same thing for zakah, ولكن الأصل في الأمور دي إنك أنت تغطي حاجة الفقراء اللي هم الذين يعيشون في إيه في المدينة التي تعيش فيها. يعني the purpose of the zakah is to fulfill the needs of the poor and the needy in your local area, in your city, right? That's the purpose of the zakah. So also, so because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says فَفِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٌ, that miskin can be even a non-Muslim miskin. There is no such any, like any dalil anywhere in the Quran and Sunnah that you need to feed a Muslim, a poor Muslim. There is no dalil. Allah left it open. Any miskin. Right, any miskin, Muslim or non-Muslim. And most of the ulama, most of the scholars actually are of the opinion that zakah and zakatul fitr and zakatul mal must be paid first to take care of the needy of your area. And then unless you have poor relatives, if you allow عندك أقارب فقراء, unless you have poor relatives, then poor relatives, they take precedence over other people. But always in general, this is what I would suggest and recommend. I would always say keep one portion of your sadaqah or a portion of your kafara or one portion of your zakah just for here. Because if you ask me and Brother Khushid, I'm not here, if he's here or not, we're part of the sympathy committee, and we do have lots of poor people and lots of needy people. We do have a lot. And we deal with them almost on a daily basis. That people sometimes are in the street. We're talking about Muslims are in the street. They're homeless. They are in a hotel. They are kicked out of the homes with their children. And they have no even money for food. So we do have some severe cases here. That's why it's important, inshallah ta'ala, instead of sending everything there, just to make sure that you save one portion of your sadaqat or your kafara or your zakah for here, inshallah ta'ala. So these are about vomiting, about traveling, and about bismillah sending the kafara to another state or another country or overseas. Of course, lots of people say, can I do blood work during the month of Ramadan? That is permissible. There is nothing wrong with that. Can I take injection while fasting? Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. Okay? Can I put eye drop? Nothing wrong with that. Can I do kuhl? Nothing wrong with that. Can I use miswak? Can I brush my teeth? Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. These are all permissible while fasting. But I would recommend, especially if you want to brush, then make sure that you use a toothpaste that is, free scent, that doesn't have any flavor. It doesn't have any flavor. Even some of the ulama says there is no difference because you don't swallow anything. So even they said brushing your teeth in general is permissible during the days of Ramadan. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Usama radiallahu says, رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يستاك في رمضان ما لا يعد ولا يحصى. I have seen the Prophet using the miswak during the days of Ramadan many, many, many times during the days of Ramadan. So that is perfectly fine, inshallah, azza wa jal. Some people, that's very important. Sometimes people exaggerate too much and they go too far. You know that spray that you use to, what do you call it? not the inhaler. It just gives you, yes. Yeah, like a breath mint. They just, yeah, to make it your smell, breath smell good. This is not permissible. Yeah, brushing is okay, but you're not allowed to spray anything inside your mouth. And this is part of fasting, subhanAllah. As it says the Prophet, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِ مُحَمَّدْ بِيَدِهِ لَخَلُوفُ فَمِ الصَّائِمِ أَطْيَبُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ رِيحِ الْمِسْكِ, that the smell of the mouth of the fasting person is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the scent of musk. But in general, using the miswak or brushing your teeth during the days of Ramadan, I see it permissible and I don't see anything wrong with it, inshallah ta'ala. That's what we have from online before. And then inshallah ta'ala, now we'll open the floor for a Q&A session from our brothers here and also brothers and sisters online. Brother Khalid? Yes. Yes. Going to a dentist. Yeah, dental cleaning. Yes, going to a dentist. During the month of Ramadan, right, there is nothing wrong. That is permissible. It is permissible to work on your teeth while fasting. It is permissible, inshallah ta'ala, because you don't actually swallow anything. Right? So that is okay. But I would say, honestly speaking, what I would put it, just to be on the safe side, if it's something emergency, then yes. But if something that you're okay and just for the sake, your appointment came in Ramadan for cleaning, I would recommend that you postpone this until the month of Ramadan. Unless you're in pain, then this is a different story. If you're not in pain and you're fine, it's just a follow up, then I would say don't do it until the month of Ramadan, until after Ramadan, inshallah. Okay, this is very important, inshallah. Tfaddal hajjan.
سنتين بعد الهجرة. أكان الرسول موجود ولا لا؟
نعم.
يعني 15 سنة.
كان معهم. كان يصوم, ولكن كان يصوم يوم عاشوراء فقط.
بس
فقط. ما فيش أيام ثانية. رمضان كان موجود كشهر, ولكن لم يفرض صيامه. كان موجود كاسم, ولكن لم يفرض صيامه على النبي ولا على الصحابة إلا بعد الهجرة. حتى same حج علي ثابت سان. So before the obligation of fasting, yes, as I said, the Sahaba used to fast, but only the day of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, and even zakah was made obligatory upon the month of Ramadan, was made mandatory upon Muslims in the second year of the Hijrah. But the Sahaba before, the payment of zakah was optional, and also it was not, what they call it, after when it was made obligatory, then you know the amount, 2.5%. Before that, it was left up to you. You decide the amount that you want to pay. For 15 years, the Sahaba just are the ones who decide how much I want to pay. And it was optional. You want to pay it, you want to pay. And also you decide the amount. Until the second year of the Hijrah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the ayat of fasting and the ayat of zakah. That's the question. Yes, what they used to do before
for
fasting,
before
the obligation of Ramadan. Okay. Yes. Okay. Do we have? Let's take one online and one from here. Do you have anyone?
Online, no, Sheikh, but from our brother here. Uh-huh. When it comes to engaging with the Quran in Ramadan, which approach do you recommend? Do we read with the aim of intent to finish reading it by the end of the month, or do we read in order to memorize new surahs? Or do you read it with the intent to reflect and engage the heart of what you are reading?
Number three? Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Last one, Sheikh.
You read Quran with the intent to reflect and contemplate with tadabbur, right? Even though many of the ulama, they said it's recommended to finish the Quran once during the month of Ramadan, to go over the Mus'haf, just to recite the Quran. But this is just, it's an opinion. However, I would highly, as I said in the khutbah, encourage the recitation of the Quran with tadabbur. I would, as I said, I would, if someone were to ask me, I would say just take one surah from the Quran, focus on it, and understand it during the month of Ramadan. Study that surah to its tafsir, And subhanAllah, it makes a big difference in a person's life.
Next one is, when it comes to the shayateen being chained up during the month of Ramadan, what does this mean in regards to their influence? Is it weakened or is it nullified completely? Or does it mean that the evil that a person does is from his or her soul?
Yeah, that's the purpose. Shayateen are chained up because it's Ramadan is a period of training. You can evaluate the nature of your soul. The nature of your soul. So what happens during the month of Ramadan, right? So sometimes when we do, what happens, we blame shayateen for everything that we do. But during the month of Ramadan, now you will come to know, is it really, which one has a strong effect and influences you the most? The shaitan or the soul? If there is no shaitan in Ramadan, and then subhanAllah, some people still disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and there is no change, then this is actually from their souls. And that's why one of the du'as of the Prophet in the khutbah, وَنَعُوذُ بِكَ مِن شُرُورِ أَنفُسِنَا. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils within our souls. So Ramadan is a period of training where you can evaluate the nature of the soul and you see what type of soul you have. You know, there is a nafs mutma'inna, as the Quran says, and there is nafs ammara, and there is nafs lawwama. It's a type of soul that's very content and pleased with the will of Allah. Another soul that is, pushes its person to ammara, to do acts of disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is a nafs al-lawama. Nafs al-lawama is the self-reproach, where the one that blames the person always for the evil or the sins that they commit. So yes, the shayateen are chained up, that is true. That's literally they are chained up, meaning they have zero impact or zero effect on the fasting people during the month of Ramadan. Yes.
Regarding the Prophet, I read through some of the opinions, especially Shafi'i, said the Prophet has to be before Fajr. Like, it's not like if you want to travel in the middle of the day, you can't.
That is very true, yes.
So is that like something, I know it depends, like Bilad al-Sham Shafi'i, here, I don't know what we call it.
Yeah.
I don't know, Egypt, I think Malik.
Egypt is Shafi'i. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Yes. If someone, for example, you have, in order for you to break the fast, okay, for traveling, then you must have the intention of traveling. And it must take place, yes, not just in the middle of the day. And you decide, okay, I have to go, and then you break your fast, this is not permissible. Yes, according to the vast majority of the scholars, the travel must happen before the Fajr. Or you have the intention of traveling. Or at least you have the intention of traveling.
Intention.
Yes, the intention. Meaning, yes, you have the intention the day before. So I know, for example, that tomorrow that I'm going to travel. Then yes. But if it happened just all of a sudden in the middle of the day, then the ulama said, such a person is not permissible to break their fast. They have to continue the day. Unless there was an intent the night before or the day before that you're going to travel. That's all of them. Most of them, with the exception of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He was a little bit flexible in this matter. He said, even if someone intends to travel in the middle of the day, then still. Others, they said, no, intention must be made before. Must be made before. Yes.
So, but sometimes, you know, things happen and you need to travel.
Yes.
So, essentially, from what you're saying is the travel that you know in advance, you have a.
Correct.
But if you, let's say, you have a news that someone's sick, you know, you need to go, like, down to visit someone who's in hospital or something. You didn't know in advance, you have to kind of travel. In that case, it looks like that.
For the vast majority of the scholars, is not there.
Okay.
Yes.
But there is no consensus.
Yes, no, there is no ijtima on this. There is no ijma on this. Even if you go take the other option, it's still valid, inshallah.
Yes.
Can
you swallow?
Absolutely, yes. There is not. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Swallowing your saliva while fasting, does not affect your fasting in any way at all. At all. Does not. Yes. Okay.
From Umm Ibrahim, she says, what about your qareen? Is it also tied up during Ramadan? Can you explain?
Well, some of the ulama said the qareen is the nafs. Some of the ulama said the qareen is وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرَ الرَّحْمَنِ نُقَيِّدْ لَهُ شَيْطَانَ فَوَلَهُ قَرِينَ. And there is no, there is another hadith that says the Prophet مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا وَلَهُ قَرِينَ حَتَّى أَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ أَنَا إِلَّا أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَعَانَنِي عَلَيْهِ فَأَسْلَمْ. So every single one of us has a qareen. And then they said, even you, O Prophet of Allah. He said, yeah, even me, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has helped me. And then he accepted Islam. So the Prophet's qareen actually became Muslim. So during the month of Ramadan, again, the hadith is very general. That وَصُفِّدَتِ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Right? So the devils are chained up. Are chained up. That includes your qareen, includes Iblis and his soldiers, includes everyone. You will only be left with your soul. You will only be left with your nafs during the month of Ramadan. You will only be left with your nafs during the month of Ramadan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
Sheikh, sometimes we come for suhoor at the masjid and like we eat something bad. We pray Fajr, we go home and we feel something in our stomach like we need to get it out. But some people, they don't throw up very easily. They need to force themselves to throw up.
If you force it under any conditions, it does break your fast. If you force vomiting under any condition, it does break your fast. But if it comes by itself naturally, then that is perfectly fine. If you force it, even though you don't feel comfortable and you need to get rid of it and you did something, then it does break your fast and you have to make up that day after Ramadan. Okay? Inshallah. We're good. Any other question? Yes.
Do we stop eating at Fajr or do we still have time until the sun rises?
No, you stop eating with Fajr Adhan. Not until even the Adhan, the end of the Adhan. As soon as you hear Allahu Akbar, you need to stop. And if you hear Allahu Akbar, Fajr Adhan, and you have something inside, then you're not even allowed to swallow that. You have to spit that completely. And it's always better to stop for a few minutes before Fajr. الصحابة كانوا يتوقفون قدر 50 آية قدر 50 آية من القرآن الكريم. يعني كانوا يتوقفون, you know, the time that takes you to recite 50 آية from the Quran. يعني but Islamically, okay, that's it. We cannot take يعني this as it has to be done this way, but Islamically, okay, from the Sharia point of view, you can eat and drink until you hear Allahu Akbar. Once you hear Allahu Akbar, you stop. And if you have something inside, you spit it. You take it out. That's when you stop eating, exactly. And but subhanAllah, as I said, give yourself a few minutes before Fajr, so you can brush, you can make wudu, you can, but you can definitely eat until Fajr Adhan. Lots of people sometimes they go by what the Quran says, حَتَّى يَتَبَيَنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ, until you see the white thread from the the black thread, and then they wait and even they don't. This is very, you're actually risking your entire month. So I think alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with the time, right? And just to follow the time. Right, follow the time. Some days if we don't have the time, you may end up sometimes even breaking your fast after Asr. And it happened at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It was very cloudy. And the Sahaba thought that the sun already has set. And they came to know and they broke their fast. And then after that, the sun appeared again. And they were commanded to make up that day after the month of Ramadan. So subhanallah, if you go by this, alhamdulillah, it's not that easy. So we have the time right now, we just go by the time, bi-idhnillah, just to be on the safe side. Okay. Allah ybarik fikum, jazakumullahu khayran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all, and may Allah increase your knowledge, and Ramadan Mubarak in advance, inshaAllah.